Hello, happy Sabbath, everybody. Thank you for joining tonight. My name is Gerald, Papa. We will have a program. This is our fifth day of prayer. We will have Ziki start us off with a word of prayer. Then I'll do a scripture reading, which is going to be followed by a song, and then we'll welcome our speaker right after that. And then I think we should be getting ready to wrap up after a song and a closing prayer. All right. Okay. So if Ziki is in, maybe you could do an opening prayer for us.
Good evening. Let's bow down for a word of prayer. God, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for the Sabbath that has started, Lord. We thank you for the prayer sessions that you've had throughout the week, Lord. And as we are having another one today, Lord, we pray that you may bless us, Father. May you use the speaker. May you talk to us, Father. May you help us to get closer to you through this session, Lord. We pray that you may help us not to leave this place the same, Lord, and we pray that you may help us to bless those next to us, Father, with what we learn. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen and amen. Thank you so much, Ziki. The scripture for today is from Judges chapter 6, from verse 1 to 10, and I'm going to read it. It says, Then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. So the Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian for 7 years. And the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel. Because of the Midianites, the children of Israel made for themselves the dens, the caves, and the strongholds which are in the mountains. So it was whenever Israel had sown, Midianites would come up, also Amalekites, and the people of the east would come against them. Then they would encamp against them and destroy the produce of the earth as far as Gaza and leave no sustenance for Israel, neither sheep, nor ox, nor donkey. For they would come up with their livestock and their tents, coming in as numerous as locusts, both they and their camels were without number, and they would enter the land to destroy it. So Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. And it came to pass, when the children of Israel cried out to the Lord because of the Midianites, that the Lord sent a prophet to the children of Israel, who said to them, "Thus says the Lord, God of Israel, I brought you up from Egypt and brought you out of the house of bondage, and I delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians, and out of the hand of all who oppressed you, and drove them out before you and gave you their land. Also, I said to you, I am the Lord your God. Do not fear the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell, but you have not obeyed my voice." That's the word of the Lord. So the media team is going to cue in music, and right after that, we're going to have our speaker, Michael Avery, take over. Media team.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. Happy Sabbath. Let's have a word of prayer again. Loving Lord, we thank you for this time now to open up your word as we take our lessons from Judges chapter 6 and 7 about the story of Gideon. We're learning, Lord, as we live in life, that this battle belongs to you. Our subject is the battle of fearfulness. Some are fighting this battle right now. Some have come through a long week of battles. And there may be some situations that are fearful, Lord. But we know that with you, all things are possible, and this battle belongs to you. So help us to learn this lesson, even as we study Gideon tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. We thank you for Gerald leading out and reading scripture for us. On Monday night, we were blessed to hear Elder Allen tell us about the battle of impossibilities. On Tuesday, Sylvia broke it down for us plainly about the battle of understanding. On Wednesday, Pastor Akeem eloquently highlighted and took us to that better place about the battle of reassurance. And then on Thursday, Jack, I hear it is the mic is still on fire because you helped us with the battle of discouragement. But tonight, I want to just highlight just a few things from Gideon. We all know the story, but he had a situation with the battle of fearfulness. Yes, fearful times for Israel. Some of you that have not yet gone through the entire book of Judges, I ask you to take time and study the word and go through it. Will you find when you read that Israel was going through a dark period? There was servitude under the Midianites, chapter 6 through 8. There was servitude under the Ammonites, chapters 11 and 12. There was servitude under the Philistines. We all know Samson in chapters 13 through 16. But tonight, the story is about Gideon. Gideon tells us today that we need to learn that battle belongs to the Lord. Gideon experienced the battle of impossibilities. He experienced the battle of understanding. He experienced the battle of reassurance. He experienced the battle of discouragement, and he experienced the battle of fearfulness. Fearful times under the constant hand of the Midianites. So these nomadic tribe and tribe that wanted to do evil to Israel, what they would do is wait until Israel had done all of the work in the field. They had sweat, labor, and equity in planting their crops and waiting for the food and the grain to be ready for harvest. These Midianites would come in and then take the grain and the food and destroy their crops. It got so bad that every year, for 7 years constantly, this would take place and food became scarce. And Israel was on the verge of starvation. Fearful times indeed when you do not have food. You know you're in a battle when you don't have food, when you're hungry. And so it got so bad that Israel, now we're talking about the church Israel. We're talking about God's people. It got so bad for them at this point that for some reason they decided to call on the Lord. I don't know who remembered, but they remembered the Lord enough to start calling on his name. And they cried out, the Bible says, unto him. I want you to know there's nothing worse in life than fear. If I may ask you, what are you afraid of today? You afraid of not being able to pay your bills? Afraid of losing your job? Or are you afraid of evil people? Are you afraid of someone stealing your money? Fearful times. Maybe you know someone close to you maybe even your best friend, or only to find out that this best friend isn't who you thought they were. Maybe you are doing everything you can to do and keep things moving forward, but you find yourself taking one step forward, but life somehow is taking you three steps back in the wrong direction. Somebody today is looking over their shoulders, running from something or someone. You're hearing voices. You're feeling feelings that shouldn't be felt. Fearful time. What you do when you find you're addicted to the wrong things. If you see the wrong thing. If you do the wrong things. No matter how much you try to just stop it, you know it is not right, but somehow, in some way, you keep on doing it. You know better. Fearful times. Not just outside the church, but inside the church. What are you afraid of? Let's take it to the word again. Let's pick up where Gerald left off in Judges. If you have your Bibles, chapter 6, we'll start with verse 11 through 13. And God's word says, "Now the angel of the Lord came and sat upon the thyrabim tree." That's an oak tree. It's kind of like a big oak tree, which was in Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abizite, which his son Gideon threshed wheat in a wine press. And you want to know why was he in a wine press in a small place? He was trying to hide so that the Midianites would not take the food and take the grain. But the word says he threshed wheat in a wine press in an order to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, "The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor." Gideon said unto him, "O my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? Why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his miracles which our fathers told us about, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt?' But now the Lord has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites." You know, Gideon may have had a point. He knew, though, that the sins of the people caused God's presence to leave the nation. But somehow Gideon's faith did not grasp the truth that when people cry out to God, he gladly returns for them to help them. And it's no different for us today when we have painful circumstances. The question is, do we have weak faith? Gideon's faith was weak during these times. But let's continue with what the Lord adds in verse 14. "And the Lord turned to him and said, 'Go in this might of yours, and you shall save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have I not sent you?' So he said to him, 'O my Lord, how can I save Israel? Indeed, my clan is weakest in Manasseh, and I'm the least in my father's house.' And the Lord said unto him, 'Surely I will be with you, and you shall defeat the Midianites as one man.' Then he said unto him, If now I have found favor in your sight, then show me a sign that it is you who talk with me. Do not depart from here, I pray, until I come to you and bring out my offering and set it before you. I'm telling you, Gideon's faith was weak. Do we all know who the angel of the Lord was? Do we all know that was Jesus? And yet, here it is, he's face to face with him, and he still, for some reason, doesn't believe in his words. The Lord is trying to reassure him he is with him, but he doesn't believe for some reason. As we continue to read, and we're going to fast forward, we find that Gideon went to go get some meat, some bread, and some broth, brought it before the angel of the Lord, verse 21. And the angel of the Lord put out the end of the staff that was in his hand and touched the meat and the unleavened bread, and fire rose out of the rock and consumed the meat and the unleavened bread. And the angel of the Lord departed out of his sight. Now Gideon perceived that he was the angel of the Lord. So Gideon, alas, O Lord God, for I have seen the angel of the Lord face to face. Verse 23. And then the Lord said unto him, Peace be with you. Do not fear. You shall not die. Whatever Gideon felt, whatever he was thinking, he had to be reassured constantly by this angel of the Lord that God was with him. He didn't have to worry. He didn't have to be afraid. As we fast forward in the scripture, we find, as you read, that he was asked, the Lord asked, and commanded that Gideon destroy the altar of Baal. And it just so happens his father had erected this altar of Baal. We're talking about how far things can go wrong inside the church. And God was using Gideon to set it straight. And Gideon did just what the Lord said, and he took 10 men. Verses 28 through 33, and Gideon destroyed the altar of Baal. At this time, when the Midianites found out who it was, they were ready to kill him. His father said, No, why don't you let Baal do it? Since Baal is a little G-O-D, let's see what power he has. So the Midianites and Amalekites gathered together, and they were ready to attack Israel because of this. But let's jump to verse 34, and it says, But the Spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon. Then he blew the trumpet, and the Abzarites gathered behind him, and he sent messengers throughout all Manasseh, who also gathered behind him. And he also sent messengers to Asher and Zebulun and Naphtali, and they came up to meet him. So everybody was there. And here it is once again. He did not have that faith, and he asked for another sign. Gideon continues to ask God for reassurance that he is with him, and he said, I have this fleece of wool. Let it be wet with dew in the morning, but the ground dry. And guess what happened? The next morning, it was so. But then he started to reason and think and judge and said, well, let's make this a little bit harder. Why don't we let this fleece of wood, Lord, be dry that is wet, and the ground dry, And so what happened was, it happened just as he said. So here it is. Gideon was allowed to test the Lord. The Lord constantly is answering his prayer and guaranteeing him that he's with him. And yet he still seems to be a little shaken and not sure. As we continue to read on in chapter 7 of Judges, we find Gideon started out with 32,000 men to fight this battle with the Midianites. But God had another plan, and God says, listen, verse 2, and the Lord said to Gideon, the people who are with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands, lest Israel claim glory for itself against me, saying, my own hand has saved me. Verse 3, now therefore proclaim in the hearing of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and afraid, let him turn and depart at once from Mount Gilead. And the Bible says 22,000 of the people returned home, and only 10,000 remained. Brothers and sisters, imagine the church. Imagine the church full. And then the Lord comes and says, if you're afraid, go home. And 22,000 people get up and walk out to church. Leaves just a remnant of only 10,000 people. What is going on? Would you have been one of the 22,000 that walked out to church? Or would you have been one of the 10,000 that stayed? I'll let you answer that. Historians say that the Midianite army numbered 135,000. So what can 135,000 men do with 10,000? That should be pretty easy, you would think, right? But the Lord says, listen, 10,000 is still too many. We all know the story. The Lord says, I have another test. Send them down to the water, and everyone who laps up the water like a dog gets down on all fours and laps it up with their tongue. They will go home. Those that put the water, cup it with their hand and bring it to their mouth, they're the ones that will fight the battle. And out of 10,000 people, you got to be kidding me. Only 300 of them properly got water. 300 properly got water and put it to their mouth. How does the story end? Well, we know how it all ends. God wins every time. With Gideon and the 300 men, the Lord fought the battle. Here's what they did. They didn't fight with weapons, y'all. You know the story, right? They didn't fight with weapons. Here's what they did. The Lord is fighting the battle for them. So he told Gideon, and Gideon said, just do this and follow what I do, and we're going to win this battle. So with Gideon and the 300 men, they went up on a cliff looking down on the Midianites, and the Lord fought the battle for them. For they stood, they blew their horns, they waved their torches, their lamps, and they shouted this, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. That's all they did. That's all they did. And it created such a panic in the camp of the Midianites that the whole camp, the whole army ran off. And if you were continuing to read the Bible, you would read how the rest of the Israelites followed to take care of business because the Lord had delivered them from their enemy. The battle truly belongs to the Lord. We have no need to fear when God is with us. I thought I would get an amen from somebody. We have nothing to fear when God is with us. I want you to see that the biggest battle that was going on during this whole story had nothing to do outside. It had to do inside in Gideon's mind. He needed to surrender his fears to God's will before the victory was won. It was not because Gideon had more men. It was not because Gideon had more weapons. But he won because the Lord was with him. The Bible says in Zechariah 4:6, not by might nor power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. Yes, fear is powerful. But God's presence and peace is more powerful. Jesus' love for his people is victorious more and now and forever to give you perfect peace each and every day. I want to also tell you, coming out of 1 John 4:18, that there is no fear in love, true love. But perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. Our lesson for this evening, God offers us his peace to overcome our fears. Don't let your heart be anxious or troubled, for the eternal God, the angel of the Lord, fights your battles. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you so much for the example of Gideon, and we praise your holy name that you fight our battles. We don't have to do anything but put our trust and our faith in you, and you will let us know what to do. Gideon didn't have to do anything but stand and blow his horn, wave his little light, and shout. Oh, Lord, if you would give us what we need to do to stand and do the right thing for you. I pray that each one of us today would turn our trust and faith to you so that our fear would dissipate and that our love would grow and that we'll have a closer walk with thee. For this is our prayer. Thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much, tag team. Thank you so much, tech team. If you could cue in us some music, and Petra, you can get ready to get us a prayer, and we'll be up there.
Fashioned against us will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. When the power of darkness comes in like a flood, the battle belongs to the Lord. He's raised up a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power, and strength to the Lord. To the Lord.
Let us pray.
Our kind and loving Heavenly Father, just want to pause for this moment to thank you for this welcoming, happy Sabbath day on which we all come together under the full knowledge through your Holy Spirit about the battle of fear. Heavenly Father, we're only human, as you know. We have our days when we're just like Gideon. But God, we already know that you, our Heavenly Father, has gone before us and has set the race, Heavenly Father. It's just for us to put our trust in you 100% and know that you will deliver. You are the God of Jacob. You're the God of Isaac. You're the God of our beloved Joseph. And Heavenly Father, once we cast our cares upon you, we know you said in your words, fear not, because you're with us always. And as the three Hebrew boys, Daniel in the lion's den, if we all have faith as small as a mustard seed, we can move mountains. Dear God, we cast all our cares upon you because we know that you care for us. Bless us this day as we ask these mercies. In your son Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Petra. That brings us to the close of today. Thank you so much for coming once again. We will gather again next week on Monday at 8 p.m. So we'll see you all next week, Monday. Thank you so much.
Amen. Amen.
Blessings, everyone. Have a good evening. Blessed Sabbath day.
Amen. Same to you.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.